Let's just begin with the approach which you believe should have been quite different in how this panel did its work, because they had looked at the items that needed to be zero rated, and you're saying perhaps that's not the best way of looking at it, that it's not about the items, but it's about how best do we leave poor households in a better position overall without touching the VAT.
Good evening to you. Well, I think we're all on the same page here, whether it's you, me, or the panel, or Parliament. We want to see how we can mitigate, in particular, the impact of the increase in VAT on the poorer households. And a certain mandate was given to the panel, and I think they've done it very conscientiously. There's a lot of homework, and they've responded to the mandate. I think the question in my mind is, however, is this the best way? Because when you look at the statement by the National Treasury, which accompanied the release of this report, they did say, look, we need to satisfy ourselves in our inputs on these recommendations, whether they will in fact significantly benefit the poorer households, and in particular, are they consistent with our fiscal framework? I bear in mind in looking at these recommendations that both the previous Katz Commission into tax reform and indeed also the Davis Committee recently, they resisted increasing this list. They said, look, there are better ways. We must look at the expenditure side. Can we target the poorer households more directly? I use this analogy. It's a choice between the shotgun and the rifle. The shotgun, you spread the shot and you hope that some people will hit the target and will walk into shops and be better off. Or do you put cash into their pockets? That's the rifle. And that's where I think there is a debate as to whether it's better to increase the list of the zero-rated items, which have problems, because obviously it means that the government loses revenue, which it then can't spend on other desirable things. It means you and I will benefit, and I don't see why we should. It should be more targeted. So I think that debate's not over. But I can understand why the panel did arrive at what they thought was perhaps a second best, but a more acceptable answer.
We'll talk about the alternatives in the moment, because one of the issues that you've brought about is that around food stamps and perhaps looking at the model of what they do in the US. But before we get there, when you look at these items, and when you look at the food basket that is compiled almost monthly by some organizations around what poor households are consuming in this country, do you think that ultimately it will not benefit them to the full extent that it could?
Well, I think even the panel says, look, this is not ideal, but this is what we've come up from, this is our mandate, and we've put our best foot forward in order to identify what could be done. The problem is that, I come back to my point, it's very much a shotgun approach, because once you walk into the supermarket in a few months' time, if a decision is taken that there will be an enlargement of this zero-rated list, will you notice the difference? Or will it get lost somewhere in the system? And even the panel says, look, you ought to be sure that these benefits will be passed on. So there are a lot of ifs and buts. I am very sympathetic to what they've recommended, but I just have some doubts as to whether, from an economic point of view, it's the most efficient way, a way in which people will say, there's cash in my pocket, I feel a difference. They walk into a supermarket and I wonder whether that price is now 15% lower.
How would the food stamps be different? And perhaps, you know, when it comes to food stamps, we're already taking into account that this is a part of South Africa's population that is also largely living off the grants that are given by government. And so in terms of costing, how would that ultimately then work out, very briefly?
Well, it's the same principle. Mm. Social grants are a direct assistant. And when you look at food stamps, they are targeted. It's targeted assistance. You and I would not qualify in the United States for food stamps, but it's been going for several decades, and it's been a wonderful shock absorber in terms of food costs, of being able to help the poorer households, because it's targeted, you can budget for it, you know exactly what it's going to cost you, and it's aimed at the people who need it most. And that's, I think, the principle, wherever we can, that we should support, that where the government needs to assist, where we need to alleviate hardship in the poorer households, we target it in a way that people feel the difference. For me, that's first prize, and I hope that we don't now give up on the principle that we can target government expenditure in ways that will make people feel better off, rather than resorting to more indirect measures where people might not be sure as to whether they're going to benefit or not. So I think all the inputs that will be given over the next few weeks, because the National Treasury has asked for, so I think we need to raise these issues. And so whatever the final decision, we hope it will be based on the best advice and inputs we can get, so that the poorer households feel they have truly benefited by this process.
And lastly, just before I let you go, of course, one of the challenges that also might be an issue now is in the hands of retailers in terms of actually implementing the zero-rated VAT policies. There are concerns that some retailers might in fact not ensure that cost is adjusted accordingly, and instead of it filtering down to the consumer, they get to keep the difference for themselves. In fact, it's a concern that's also been raised by a trade union today.
But it's also raised by the panel. Mm-hmm. They admit that there are imperfections out in the marketplace which may blunt the impact of this. And so that's an important issue, which is also why I prefer the direct approach, putting some money into people's pockets in a way that is tangible, which is measurable, and which they can use. And then it comes back, of course, to the bigger issue that however much we debate these issues, when the Minister of Finance stands up in Parliament in 2 months' time and introduces his mini budget, he's going to have to explain how he's going to incorporate this, whatever the decisions, plus other important fiscal decisions, into that mini budget, so that he sends out a message of confidence. He's got the public finances under control. He's addressing the key issues that we need, including helping the poor households in turning this economy around.
All right, well, we certainly hope that you will be taking some of these recommendations that you've shared with us tonight to that panel. As you heard, the public still having until the end of this month to make their submissions. That was Professor Raymond Parsons. He is with the Northwest University's Business School.